One, two. You're here. Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for coming for this great event, for great cause, for Haiti benefit. And we have a privilege to share a couple songs with you tonight, so I hope you will enjoy. So we'll start with a couple of them.
Thank you. singers for just opening the evening for us. They were great, amen. Yeah. My name is Pastor Bill Grogan, and probably almost everybody here knows that. I've been around a long time. And it's my just blessing and privilege to be here for this Haiti fundraiser. My life was changed forever the first time I went to Haiti. And something burned in my heart to just go back and to go back again. And it was Ian who persuaded me to go the first time, and he just said this to me. He said, you know, if you wanted being once, you'd want to go again and again. So I'm glad he did that. And Pastor Ian is going to be sharing with us a bit later on. And also, it really is our privilege to have Pastor Leslie Bertrand from Haiti with us. He's the gentleman who oversees the Grace Churches and the orphanages and all the other things which take place. But now I just want to take a few moments just to ask our team to come up and just to introduce themselves. That's yours, Wild Ocean.
I'm Gosha.
My name is Rachel.
I am Jennifer.
Hello, my name is Christine.
I'm Renee Farrington.
I'm Ryan.
And these are just a fantastic group of people. I want to tell you that we work together, and they were just a dream team to work. Just a tremendous blessing. And before I hand over now, apparently I've got to say something about face painting. What was that?
That's the face painting for the kids after.
While we were in Haiti, we face painted a lot of the kids' faces while they were waiting for the medical clinic. So we'll have a gal out there during dinner. We'll be doing that. Okay.
And it's a free donation.
And a donation.
It's just a free donation. Okay, thank you.
Hi! Just making sure you're all awake. I heard Bill preach and he puts everyone to sleep. I'm kidding. It's great that you could be here with us tonight. And we're just enjoying being able to go to Haiti and to bless the work there. I want to ask, before Leslie comes up to speak to you, I want to ask Renee, would you just come up and share a little bit about what you went through? Try not to tell too much bad stuff about Pastor Bill, but tell us some good stuff, all right? Here's Renee. She came with the team last year, and she had a big hand in helping put this thing on tonight. So welcome her, and listen to what she has to say.
Hey. I want to thank you guys for coming here tonight. Very, very thankful. I ended up going to Haiti because Bill just stopped by my house and said, you know, maybe you should come to Haiti. I said, okay. And I put on a fundraiser last year, and this town was so generous with giving money that I had enough money left over to ask some friends to come, and thankfully they came. The first day that we were there, we were driving through Port-au-Prince, and there was about 13 of us shoved inside of a VW van. It was hot, and we were sweaty, and we're driving through, and I thought, what have I done? I've brought these people here. Where are we? It's just so different from where I'm from. And the day that we left, we were driving through Port-au-Prince, not wanting to leave because we fell in love with the people of Haiti. It was absolutely an amazing thing to come from a land of so much to a land of so little. But people were not complaining, like I hear so often here. I wanted to show you this. Now, I wouldn't take this to my daughter Zion. You like a drink of water? Okay, well, she trusts me, so she wants to take it. But during the medical clinics, one of the main issues that we saw was dehydration. And so we thought, well, why don't we just help dig wells and get these people clean water? Well, they have tried to dig wells, and there isn't water. Like 46% of the country does not have access to clean water that we can just get out of the tap at any time. And dehydration causes all kinds of issues. And when they were singing up there, I was hearing, I want to love like you love, and that's what our God calls us to do. And to go into a place and give of ourselves, even for a week or 2 weeks, can literally change your life and change how you look at things. When we were there, I asked Pastor Leslie, what can we do? Like, what can we do? We've come and we've put on these clinics for a week. We fell in love with the people, but I'm going to go home and I'm going to run my business, and what can I do? And he said three things. Number one, be absolutely give everything you have to God. Every single bit of your life to God. Okay? And he can handle things. And number two, do not look at this trip to Haiti as an adventure that we went on, but come home and advocate. And so that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to reach your hearts and say, okay, there is a real need out there. If you feel some tug at your heart, do something about it. And the third thing that he said to do is be thankful for everything we have. If I open my cupboard and there's food in it, thank you, God. If I go to start my old truck and it starts and I get to work, thank you, God. If I get home, thank you, God. Thankful for every single thing that we have. So I just encourage you to go do something, because our lives are short, and it does just take one person to change things. And the people of Haiti are awesome, and Pastor Leslie is awesome. And I'm so glad he's here this evening to talk to you. Come on up, please, if you would, sir.
Bonsoir, mes amis.
Bonsoir.
Good evening. I am so happy to be here to witness the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not only in Haiti, in Jamaica, in Africa, in India, but also in America. The kingdom of God is all over you. When we talk about the kingdom of God, we talk about peace, joy, happiness in our life through Jesus Christ. But I am so happy to come here to thank you for the opportunity that you give to me to share what's going on in Haiti. Maybe some of you never know where is Haiti. It is a small country, an island, share with two people, Haiti in the western part and Dominican Republic in the eastern part. They speak Spanish in Dominican Republic, and we speak French and Creole in Haiti. But our country is more mountain. Everywhere you go in Haiti, you see or found mountain. You can't imagine, because we have a lot of mountain, we cannot grow too much food, because most of our mountains, they are rocky. People cut too many trees to make chocolate, to live, to cook, and to do a lot of things. That's why there is something in Haiti we call erosion in French. That, what is erosion? It's because there is no tree in the mountain. When it's raining, all the water from the mountain and go to the flatland, mostly we have many, many flooding. Sometimes people die when there is hurricane because people cut too many trees and mountains. And because most of our people in Haiti, they live in mountain. Some place in mountain, people walking for 3, 4, 15 hours to go to the town. There is nothing in mountain. There is no hospital, no clinic, no clean water. There is some place if you go, even you have money, you cannot buy nothing. You can find nothing. People from mountain came in town maybe every week to make grocery, something, and go back. But in order to accomplish the Great Commission, we go to the mountain, to the rural area to preach to people, to witness the people about Christ. And sometimes, when we were to the mountain people, we find a lot of orphan children. And they told us, I want to go back. I want to go in town with you. Some people in Haiti, what they do, sometimes they go far away in mountain, take some children, go in town with them, and put them in some work like slavery. You understand? Some children, maybe 6 or 7 years, or even 8, start to work for free, just for food. But, and because the love of God, we try to do something for His kingdom. Sometimes we go to the mountain, take the children and put them at some home, like orphanage home. Even many of them, they have parents, but they never go to school. Some of them spend 1 or 2 days never eat. But it is a privilege for them to find some people, take them and take care about them. That's why we have an orphanage home in Haiti with 10 boys. Some of them are really orphaned. Some of them, they have parents. But even they have parents, they like they do not have parents because their parents cannot take care. There's some little boy in Haiti, 7 years, they cost the body to work for 10, for one day, 10 cents for one day, and go back. And I am so thankful for you, American people. You open your heart to help many people all over the world. I am so thankful for you because after the earthquake, there's a lot of people from America came in Haiti to help us. People from all over America, all over the States. I found some people came in Haiti. They don't care about where they are going to sleep, where they are going to stay, because after the earthquake, there's no guest house, there's no hotel. I found some people stay in the street. They just want to come to help people. They just want to come in Haiti to save life. I pray that God continue to bless you. And also, I want to thank Pastor Bill for the team. They came in Haiti to help us with medical clinic. We went to the mountain, we went to the cities, to the rural area. More than 400 people came to see the team. Sometimes they fight. They fight. There is some place they fight. It's the only, the stronger people. will have the chance to see the medical thing, because they need. I want to thank Pastor N for his love for Haiti. He came in Haiti several times to help us, to train our pastors, to train our ministers, and also to help us with some projects, like at the orphanage home, to help us with a small farm in the back of the orphanage. And also because they have love for people, God protect some of them. When the earthquake came in Haiti, there were Haiti over there. But God protect all of them, and they go back home safe. We still have need in Haiti. We still want to take more kids in orphanage. We still have our school project, because after the earthquake, our school completely destroyed. Our church building destroyed. There is a group of the lady at this afternoon singing prayer as the building start to shake. They never see that before. Hey, all those ladies went out, and after that the building. You can imagine there's a small Pentecostal church in my hometown. They were for Bible study, about 52 people. All of them died on this afternoon with their pastor. And maybe 1 or 2 or 3 days, there is 300,000 people die in Haiti. But I know that you already saw that in news last year. We continue to bring hope for the people. That's the best. If you want to continue to live a joyful life, you need hope. Without hope, there is no life. That's why I come here last Saturday and go back home early tomorrow morning, 6 a.m., the first flight. I want to invest my life for God people in Haiti. When I was a teenager, my plan was to go to the Haitian army, to be a military, that's my goal. But God changed my plan for his purpose. God changed my plan for his glory. Instead to go to the army, God want me to sow the seed of life on these people. I believe all of you tonight, God want you to sow your seed in life. Not only in Haiti, here in Minnesota, in Africa, in Jamaica. There is something I realize among many people from America when they came in Haiti. At the end of their journey, they always told me, "Pastor, do you know something? God changed my life. I will be never the same person before, because I see how God bless us in America. But we never, never realize that. Before I come here, more than 100 people came in my orphanage home to take water. Because we have only one well in our village. People fall all over, come. We do not have access with too many things that you have here. My great pleasure to come here in America, my favorite things is to go in some supermarket to see the food. Amen? To see the food, the fish, all kind of vegetable, all kind of meat. This is my favorite thing when I come here, just to go to the Walmart and look at the food. Even we have money in Haiti, we can have it. Every day, we eat only rice and beans. Rice and beans every day. Until I come here, I can eat ice cream. Because there is no ice cream in my country. The few places that you can find ice cream is very, very, very expensive. Just for the rich people. Here you can go everywhere, you can find ice cream. You have access to go to school. We have school bus here. But the children of Haiti work for 1 hour, someplace, 2 hours, go to school, and back 2 hours, back home. No bus. Some children in Haiti, they go to school without food. Sometimes go to sleep without food. But God bless you here. But there is something sad here in America. People here never know how God bless them. They don't live a joyful life. Even we have poor, very, very poor in Haiti, but we have joy in our life. That's the lesson. If you come in Haiti, you are going to learn. Haitian people, they are very, very happy people. Amen? That's the lesson. That's the lesson. If you come in Haiti, if you go in some third world country, you are going to learn from them joy. I want to encourage you tonight to be a thanksgiving people. What's mean? Give God thanks for everything. I want to encourage you tonight to depend only upon God. Make God your God. Make God your source of everything. He provides to you salvation, healing, protection, and everything you need. God can do it for you. We still have a lot of need to help people. In our church, in our congregation, there is 51 families without home after the earthquake. There is thousands of people in Haiti still live under the tents. Don't know what's happened? There is one family in my church. one of them, the lady have baby. After 1 week, the baby die. The baby die after 1 week because it's too hot under the tent where they live. You understand? They eat under the tent, kill the baby, and the baby die. There is thousands of people now. If you go in Haiti right now, you find a lot of what we call tent city. When it's about 11 a.m., 12, 1 p.m., you see a lot of people outside of the tent because they can stay. It's too hard for them. We still have need. We still have need to help people. We have some pastor and our family of churches. They lost their house after the earthquake. Please pray for us. Pray for us and allow God to touch you. If you feel God call you to go in Haiti with Pastor Bill next January, please do it. I know when you go back, your life will be changed. You are going to see the difference between blessing and curse. You are going to make a difference between prosperity and poverty. And you are going to realize how God bless America. May God continue to bless you. May God keep your country safe. Anywhere when there are disasters, the American people is the first go to help people. It's for that reason God will continue to bless your country because you always open your heart to help others. Thank you for allowing me to talk to you. And I think Pastor Andy is going to speak more with you because he's an English people. And I am a French people. My English is very short and I have a very strong French accent. Merci beaucoup.
Can you break? Now, I just want you to understand something and think about all the things he said and all the needs he laid out to you. He never once said, "Will you please give me money?" He said, "Would you come to Haiti?" That's because it's my job to say, "Would you please give us money?" So, I want to tell you a little bit of a story, and I don't know if it's going to mess with the video guys too much if we dim some of the lights so you can see what's on the screen there. But in January of 2010, last year, I was with a team in Haiti. I was there to do a pastor's conference, and my team was there to help paint the orphanage, which had just been finished 2 weeks before. And they were going to do some other work projects around. And me being a pastor, I didn't want to do any work because everyone knows pastors only show up on Sundays and then they get paid for sitting around drinking coffee the rest of the week. But I left the team there, and literally hours before the earthquake, I left Haiti. And by the time I landed here in Minneapolis, on my way home, the earthquake happened at about 5 minutes to 5 in the evening. And I got home as my phone went off saying, there was a text message saying, "We're okay in the earthquake." And I'm going, "Who's okay and what earthquake?" And I walked in the door and I turned on the television to see what was going on. And they were just starting to get the first reports of the 7.2 Richter scale earthquake that had hit the city of Port-au-Prince. And the text message was actually from one of my team there. Amanda, who was leading the team, was preaching at the time that the earthquake happened, and we've never allowed her to preach again because she shakes the house too much. But as she was preaching, the earthquake happened, and on the way out of the building where they were, she fell over and broke her arm. And it was about 3 or 4 days before they were evacuated back to the States. It was a traumatic experience for the team, but so I'm sitting there having just got off the plane watching this thing, and for 4 days I was in front of the TV with the phone in one hand, a laptop computer on my lap, and watching the news trying to get my team out of there. A month later we went back, a friend of mine, DJ Barkin, who's a builder, and myself went back to Haiti, and Pastor Leslie took us around, and for 5 days DJ and I just wept our way around Port-au-Prince, and then on the bus on the way back to Santo Domingo because the airport wasn't open yet. And these are some of the scenes we saw, and I'm sure you've seen them all on the TV, but when you're there and you're seeing it, I'm sure some of you guys experienced this too, when you're there and you're seeing just the massiveness of the destruction that was there, the entire streets. I mean, this looks like a disaster movie from some kind of war story, but that's what these people were living with. And so we decided that we needed to do something about it. And DJ and I came back and started to work on raising a team and trying to raise some money. And this was our team that went back in April of 2010. And they're standing on the ruins of the school that Pastor Leslie has over there. Now, thank God the earthquake, let me rephrase that. The earthquake happened at about 5 o'clock. If it was at 2 or 3 in the afternoon, 150 children in that school would have lost their lives, because this is the walls of the orphanage. The orphanage is on about an acre and a half, and the perimeter walls have been dropped down, and we've been able to repair those since then. Pastor Lazy was talking about a garden that we planted so that they can have some of their own vegetables growing in there. And I don't know if any of you recognize some of the people from this area that went with us on that trip. That's what it ended up looking like, and they've had many harvests in the months of the year and a bit since that time. We also decided that we needed to help to rebuild. He's talking about 50-something families in the church that don't have homes. This is one of the families. That's the state of the home, and they were living in there with tarps and bed sheets spread over the tops of that framework. We found this little Englishman on the side of the road, and we said, if we feed you, will you work? And so he actually didn't work. He was just holding this up for the picture, and then he put it down and walked away. But that's digging one of the foundations for one of the homes that we built. We poured the slab and then started to put this. It was a modular piece that we put together. This is the second home we built out of cement block. And when we're talking about homes, we're talking about a 20 by 20 square or a 16 by 16 square that two families will live in. And there's no room division. We actually, when we went back in April this year, we put a division in there so the two families could have a little bit of privacy from each other. But as long as they're out of the sun and they're out of the rain and out of the elements, they're happy. And that's a good home for some of them. Money can't buy that. I mean, I said, we dedicated this home and we finished building it. I'm sweating, like lost 12 pounds in one day with sweat. And I said to this lady, I can't even remember her name now, Pastor Leslie, but she's a first convert of Pastor Leslie's church, Grace Assembly. She was the first convert. She's now a deaconess in the church. And so we rebuilt this house for her, and I said to her, do you like it? And she slaps me, you know, like only a woman can, and says to me, I don't like it, I love it. And she threw her arms around me and she gave me the best hug. And I thought, you know, 10 days we've been here sweating and all the other stuff that you put up with, that makes it worthwhile. And, you know, when these guys talk about the reward of going there and changing life, those are the kinds of things to do. Here's that Englishman just preaching in the church again. The church was destroyed in the earthquake. They were meeting under, if you can recognize that, that's a parachute. And it was tied up between the trees. Now, when you guys went back, it was it looked like that a little bit more. And we were able just to help them buy some timbers, and there's still a tarp that's spread out over this framework. But they got to meet for church at 6 in the morning so that it's cool enough for them to be out there. Otherwise, it gets too hot. The rest of the day, during the week, the kids were meeting under there for school. We were able to buy a motorcycle for Pastor Ivan, who's the administrator of the ministry there. By the way, let me say, Pastor Leslie is the head of about 25 churches in Haiti that are under the oversight of City Lights Ministries, which is our ministry here in the States. And we kind of help them out, and I go every year to do pastors conferences and leadership training. And then since the earthquake, we've been able to go back and help them with some of these projects. So we were able to buy Pastor Ivan a motorcycle so he can get around as well. Medical clinics are a big deal, and that's what most of these guys went to do last year and this year. We, when you do medical clinic there, these people don't have access like we have. I mean, even the poorest people, we could complain about whether we got health insurance or not in this country, but if we need it, we have medical facilities that we can go to. They don't. And so when we have a medical team go over, they can literally get 400 people coming in a day just to get what we've got to offer. And so we take all kinds of medical equipment, medical supplies, medicines, and we take them, haul them over there in suitcases, and then the first afternoon is spent putting them into little Ziploc baggies. And Jen's just kind of shaking because of all, yeah, I mean, we put enough together to service these 400 odd people that come each day to the medical clinic. And then we go out and we actually start to take care of the ladies. One of our nurses, Kathy, who couldn't be here with us tonight, just checking people out and, you know, all sorts of things. I'm not even going to begin to tell you what conditions I have, but the kids come around and they just love hanging out with us, so we kind of try to keep them amused because there's so many, and Pastor Leslie said they do fight because they want to make sure that if we're giving out vitamins or aspirin or Tylenol or antifungal creams or whatever it is that we do, these people, they want to make sure that they can get some because otherwise they don't get anything at all. And you can see it's very difficult to get any privacy when you're doing these clinics. And sometimes people want to talk about personal things, and then everyone's kind of crowded over because they want to see and they don't want to miss out on that. And that's, sorry, let me just go back to that. That's up in the mountains. Some of you have been helping Pastor Bill directly to support a school up in the mountains. That's the school. If you can look behind that thatch thing in the back there, that's the walls of the school. And that's what the kids are educated, and that's where they meet for church as well on Sundays. Just a couple of other shots. This is Pastor Maxwell and his wife. They lost their home in the earthquake. Pastor Maxwell takes care of that school I just showed you. And he also runs the church up there, and he lives downtown. He goes up to the mountain every week to take care of things up there. Right now, Pastor Maxwell and his wife are living with a number of other families in this setup here. And I mean, they're literally living shoulder to shoulder. And they need a house built, which is one of the things that we're going to try and do tonight, and I'll explain that in a minute. But here's the foundations of his house. It was wrecked in the quake. It was unfit to live in, unsafe. We went and we took a whole lot of photos. I don't have time to show them all to you. But it's ready to go. All they need is the finances to buy the materials and make it work. This is the ruins of the school that they had. 150 kids were being educated here. We just happened to catch on the photo one of the little girls standing among the ruins. That's what the school looked like. Now, some of the rubble has been cleared in this photo. But if you can imagine sitting in the classroom there, those are classrooms. If you can imagine sitting in there when those walls started to come down, it would have been horrible. That, can you imagine surviving that? And thank God the kids were out of there for that day. These are some of the kids from the school. Just we got them. They love having their photos taken with us. And they're like, take my photo. Well, are you gonna see it? No, but take my photo. So we did. And you know, you can't help but just love them. We spent any spare time we had just hugging kids. And I like to go for that as much as anything else. That's the school again under that tent. In the heat of the day, the kids just sit there and they learn. There's a couple of other strangers we found. All right, there's Pastor Bill. That's a school in the mountains. Again, some of the kids with them. Transport is a big deal. The roads in Haiti, there are no words. I mean, they really kind of scramble your lunch. But it's incredible. And then you see these cars on the road, and you can see that one's kind of pretty banged up. Somehow they kind of tie it up with rubber bands and wire, and they make them go again. And so we had, at one stage, we had about 12 people on the back of that truck on one of our trips. But, you know, we do all that. That's another, do you remember that one, Jen? We had all these people get in this thing, and they went about 50 yards up the road and got bogged in the mud. And so they all had to pile out, and they all had to push it out of the mud, and then climb back in. It was, and that was just getting out of the orphanage. It was great fun. What they need is a truck like this. It's a flatbed, and they put the canopy on the back and the little stair thing down the back, and there's bench seats in there that all the good little people sit on. And they can not only haul goods in that, they can use it for the church, they can use it for teams when they go. It's all, they need something like this. It also is able to handle the terrain a lot better than some of those little vehicles. Now, how can you help? This is the business part of the evening, all right? So don't you now, just listen to me, because I'm just going to, it only costs you $10 to get in for this dinner tonight, but this is what it's going to cost you to get out, all right? You can join our team going in January. Now, we are taking teams throughout the year, but if you want to go in January and escape some of the winter, Pastor Bill Grogan is leading the team, and the focus is medical missions. But there are some other opportunities on that trip itself. And it'll cost approximately $1,600. We were actually talking earlier this evening, we might even be able to bring that down. But, you know, all these people that are going on the team, they are raising their own money. Tonight is about seeing what the projects are and how we can work those projects. But if you want to be part of this team, $1,500, $1,600 is not that much money. And think about it, and let's, if you want to go, talk to Pastor Bill Grogan, and he's got application forms and the whole bit. All right, we need medical supplies for this team that's going in January. Now, we set a goal of about $2,000 to buy medicine. Now, don't raise your hands, but how many of you, if you went to the pharmacy and were handed medications, whether they're prescription or not, and handed medications that were out of date, how many of you would accept that? And yet when we ask for donations for medicines, most often we get given out-of-date stuff. Now, some of it is usable, but, you know, these are God's people, and they're fellow human beings, and we don't need to give them our dented, out-of-date stuff that's gone bad. Let's give them the best that we can give them, and minister to them like Jesus would minister to them, rather than just some, you know, here's the leftovers, you can have it. And so our goal is tonight is to raise approximately $2,000 for medical supplies. And we can purchase the kinds of things that they need. And believe me, all the stuff that you and I go through, they go through as well. They need relief for stomach pains. They need, in the heat and humidity, fungal infections are a big thing. Worm medication. Blood pressure medication. How many people in Haiti, Pastor Leslie, have blood pressure conditions that they just hope that their heads aren't going to explode one day from the heat and all the work that they have to do? I mean, they walk everywhere, or they ride on crowded tap-taps. But, you know, so there is plenty of things we can do. Now, we have access to some people that will supply these things to us at a good price, but we do need to be able to pick and choose what we want, what we need to take, and that means purchasing. So I want you to keep that figure in mind, all right? $2,000 for medical supplies. Now, before I go on, let me just say, I'm going to throw out some things in the next 2 minutes that might overwhelm you. And I'm doing that intentionally because the need in Haiti right now is overwhelming.
Yeah.
And what is happening is all the money that people gave to government organizations and the big multinational corporations, all the money that was given to those is being handed out with an eyedropper in Haiti right now. And I'm not saying that to put anyone down, but that's just the way it is. The bulk of the work in Haiti is being done by people like this, smaller organizations like City Lights, who are going and dealing with people one-on-one.
Amen.
So, you know, I mean, we can do a project for $5,000 that government organizations will charge $15,000, $20,000 for. Well, duh. You know, it's like, but there is a need. So I'm going to throw these things up. Please don't be overwhelmed. I am not even trying to twist your arm. If you feel like I'm twisting your arm tonight, then I want you to step back and I want you to consider carefully, is this a manipulation or is God actually speaking to your heart to give? I know I'm a pastor and I don't like people manipulating others in order to give. That's not what we're trying to do here tonight. I'm just simply laying out a need for you, and if God would touch your heart and say, hey, I want you to get involved in this, then we're going to invite you to do that, and I'll tell you exactly how in just a minute. Pastor Maxwell's house, our goal is to raise about $5,000 to help him not only build his house, but to set up a small business that will help finance his family so they can do the work of the ministry. Now you think, $5,000 to build a house and to set up a business, that's nothing. Yet it means life to these people.
Amen.
So think about that for a minute. And these are the priority needs for this team that's going in January. We have a school in Haiti that we have started to rebuild. And by the grace of God, we've got two classroom blocks already built. I think it's those two. That one's built right there, and I believe that they laid the foundations to that one last week. Is that right? And so there's another three classrooms going in. Now, one of the things we want to do is these two. One is a cafeteria block, and the other one is a classroom block. We need 9 classrooms and a cafeteria because, as Pastor Wesley said, when they come to school, sometimes they come on an empty stomach and they go home on an empty stomach. What we want to do is try and give them probably the only good meal that they're going to have that day. And so we need the cafeteria, which would then also double as a function center that will help the church and the school to raise funds by hiring it out for wedding receptions and other functions in the community. And so, but what we're going to do is we're actually going to put the cafeteria on a basement level and build the classrooms over the top of it, so it'll bring the cost of it down. But our goal to finish the school at the moment is approximately $50,000. The good thing is, if we get $5,000, then we can do $5,000 worth of work and then do the rest as we go. So keep that in mind. That's a big need. The vehicle is also a big need. We need approximately $15,000 to purchase a truck like this that will be reliable and they will fit it out. We'll just buy the flatbed and they'll fit it out. They've got welders in the church and all that will do all that stuff for them. So those are just a couple of things. Now, you might be sitting there saying, well, the earthquake happened almost 2 years ago. There's been hundreds of millions, maybe even billions of dollars given. Why are you sitting here almost 2 years, or standing here almost 2 years later asking us to help? The truth is that they still need help. We saw this sign as we were traveling around, and I thought, what a great way to encapsulate what's going on here. And so there is still help needed. Now, I know you're all hungry, and you need to get on with eating. But here's the thing. You can, some of you can write a check. Some of you might need to think about it a little bit. On your table, as you go out to dinner, on your table, there's a number of cards that you can fill out and say, hey, we would like to give to this project. Whatever touches your heart. And they're all urgent needs. There's no non-urgent need. Everything is urgent. The things that, I mean, if I told you all the stuff that's needed, you'd just walk away. But these are the most urgent needs. And if something has touched your heart, then we would encourage you to give a tax-deductible donation tonight or anytime in the future. And but we're asking you to think about this tonight. So as you go out to dinner, there's cards on the table. If you would fill them in and put them in the envelope, we'll collect them at the end of dinner tonight. Now, if you don't have a checkbook or if you'd rather give by credit or debit card, we do have that facility as well. And what we'd like you to do is write your checks out to City Lights or just CLMI. And now people have asked, well, how much of this will go to Haiti? Every cent that comes in will go to these projects. I don't take a wage from City Lights. No one gets paid administrative costs from City Lights. All the work that is done administratively for City Lights is on a voluntary basis. And so if you give $25 to a project, then $25 will go to the project. So thank you. I just want to let you know, I know some of you know me, some of you don't, but you know Pastor Bill and these people here. We want to make sure that everything we do, we're going to be able to stand before God and say, we did this correctly. And so every cent that you give towards a project will be designated to that project. If you don't want to designate it to anything, then we will prioritize it for the medical supplies, Pastor Maxo's house, and then the other things that are on there. So that's an option for you as you go out to dinner. Just one more thing. Oh, by the way, there is on each table, there is a printed proposal of what we're doing for the school in building it. I have on the table outside, there are 20 cards that are child sponsorship cards. City Lights runs a child sponsorship program. Once again, all the money from this goes to the children. We don't take out administrative costs from this. And there's a photo of the child, a little biography, and a section that you can fill out. Now, just quickly, you can pay by check, but if you're going to do it monthly, then give us a debit card or a credit card number, and on the first of the month or the business day straight after that, we will process your credit card. $25 a month, less than a dollar a day, and it'll make sure that these kids get an education, and those that need it will get a meal and maybe even some medical care and all the other things that this ministry is set up to provide. You can talk to my wife at the tables out there. We've got 20 cards tonight, and I think there's enough people here to maybe let's sponsor all 20 of them. It's not a lot of money. $25 a month, you spend more than that on Caribou. And if you don't like Caribou, you probably spend it at McDonald's or Subway or something like that. $25 a month will change a child's life. And so have a look at that. Carol's going to come and talk to you in just a minute about the silent auction. Just want to say one thing. If you are watching online and you're not here tonight and you'd like to be involved, would you just go online to citylightsministries.org, citylightsministries.org, and contact us through there if you want to sponsor a child or if you want to donate to us tonight. Thank you for watching. Thank you for being a part. And I just want to thank VidCom, and their names are Jamie Hall and Randy Kane are on the cameras, and they're helping to send this out live streaming tonight. So if you need video for anything at all, you need to call these guys and pay them twice what they ask you, because they're doing tonight for free to help us get the word out. Can we give them a hand? Thank you very much. Okay, and if you want to purchase a DVD of tonight's event just to refresh your memory or to show other people. I think they've been charged $10 each, and $3 of that is going to go to these projects. So that's another good thing that they're doing for us. Thank you. I just want to read a scripture to you as we draw this part of the evening to a close. Proverbs 11, verse 24 and 25 says this: "There is one who scatters, yet increases more, and there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself." And one other scripture in Proverbs 22 and verse 9 says, "He who has a generous eye will be blessed." What is a generous eye? Well, people that look for ways to be generous. I love the story of the Macedonian church who begged Paul to receive their offering, even though they were poor themselves. One of the things Pastor Leslie said to me as we were sitting around the table this morning, he said, "Ian, I want to use all these things so that I can give you money to go to other countries." And I'm thinking, now, I'm not looking for his money, but that's the heart, that's the mentality that the Word of God teaches, that and that we want to be involved in fostering. Because, you know, wouldn't it be great to say we had a part in helping Haiti to send missionaries to the rest of the third world? I mean, that, or maybe even to America. Who knows where America is going to be in a few years. And so let's just prayerfully consider that. I'm not going to ask you to write a check now, but as you're having dinner, and if the dinner's really good, then I helped organize it. If it's not, it was Renee's fault. No. Thank you to Wild. Can we thank Wild Time Caterer as well? I know this is a really busy weekend for them, but they made this a very high priority to be able to do this. So thank them, and if you need some catering, then see what it takes like tonight, and then go us. Now, let's pray for a minute. Father, we just thank you for this time. And we thank you for the opportunity to help others in a way that is practical. We don't want just to go and to preach to them. We want to go and to minister Jesus to them by not just giving them a hand out, but giving them a hand up. And so help us tonight to consider what our part in this would be. And I know some can go and others can't, but we can all help to send. And I pray that you would just speak to our hearts and guide us by your Spirit as we share around this dinner and consider how we would help the people of Haiti. Now, I thank you for this food. I pray you will bless it and let it be health and strength to our bodies. Redeem it from fat and calories in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, just as we go, in case anybody thinks they wouldn't be needed in Haiti because they're not medical, we need people who are helpless. The nurses, Red Cross workers, they do a tremendous job. But it's almost for every medical person we have, we need two people helping. And we are short of helpless for this trip. So please don't ever think that because you don't think you're medically accomplished that you could not be used. We need you. Thank you.
We're going to sing one more song. And when we were in Haiti, we were able to go on the top of the roof of the orphanage. And like Pastor Leslie said, the orphanage is surrounded by mountains. And when we went up at night, there was all these beautiful lights. And we had a bad day. It was a good day, but bad day because we were really sad because we weren't able to help everybody that day. And we just felt so overwhelmed, probably like you are feeling right now. And we went up on the top of the roof, looked at the city of Port-au-Prince, and we started praying and we started worshiping. And this is the song that we sang. So every time we sing this song, I think of Haiti. So join us and pray for Haiti with this song and transition to dinner.
Lord, you are its leader. You are Lord of this nation. Yeah.